All those in favour? Those against? One pass, six. Okay. Okay, I've been notified again of the following as well, as Councillor said about Councillor Walsh, Councillor Tracy Pilgrim, Jenny Cobble, and Councillor John Hare. No other apologies now? Okay, councillors, we now turn to the purpose of this meeting to consider item 3 of tonight's agenda paper to discuss the creation of the investment development manager position. The pack includes a request for an extraordinary council meeting and concerning notice of motion. May I have the move to establish, please?
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
Notice has also been given of an amendment to this motion set out on page 1 of the agenda supplements. Movers and seconders, please. Thank you. Councillor Lewis, you now have 5 minutes to speak to the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In calling this special council, it's not because we want you focused on the person. As I explain our reasons behind the request for the meeting, I hope members on all sides will recognise it is done by not using overly personalised or intemperate language against the successful applicant. I don't believe that bellowing or heckling your political opponents is particularly effective means of debate. Indeed, Mr. Mayor, this debate isn't about Mr. Liptros. It is about the creation of the post. It is about the creation of the post and the way in which Cabinet seeks to make.
Not on an individual, but on the work that's needed. I employed person on that day who I met doing a job, and he said, I didn't know all this was going on. And that's the world that we're trying to compete in. So I read some of the booklets and the material that's been prepared for us, and I look at it critically but cautiously, seeing what is this world about. I see that we're offering great areas of the development of Birkenhead and land and the assembly of sites. And I say, have we got the people? Have we got the person? Is a person in this role fulfilling what's needed? I don't know, because I wasn't at the job interviews. So in that process, in January and February and March, I emailed many members of staff. I actually emailed all members of council with the answers to a series of questions I put about how many people were interviewed, how many people responded to adverts, when did they take place, how did they narrow it down to a particular set of individuals for which the choice was finally made. But I come back to the job description, which talked about needing high-level, providing supervision and specialist high-level technical advice. So I don't know how that reaches that net. The officers to recruit, manage, motivate, direct and develop staff in that section. They're intended to provide optimum technical advice on sector targeting methods. Well, all these things are, of course, way above any pay grade I've ever aspired to. But what I do want to know, what assurance is that those qualities, those jobs that's being offered, are being undertaken. And the only way I thought we had to end this argument is having someone from outside to look at what happened after we've been through. And therefore I say, don't destroy any emails, don't destroy any files, give somebody complete access to go through all the paperwork and see whether the council, which wasn't allowed to be involved, whether those who were involved made a decision which will stand in our interests. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. I now open up to the floor.
Can I just first of all say the idea that this council is not getting sufficient time to discuss opposition items when we've had 9 extraordinary council meetings in the last year? It's just frankly, the fact is on this issue, Mr. Mayor. The starting point for this whole appointment is that we need to kind of raise our game around regeneration and investment. You know, the days of just sitting there waiting for the phone to ring have sadly gone. We've got to get out there, we've got to be promoting Wirral, we've got to be pitching for Wirral, and we're competing against not just other city regions in the UK, but throughout Europe and the world. And therefore, we know, don't we, because this government is withdrawing all support from 2021, that we need to bring in new businesses, new jobs and investment, because that's the only income we'll have beyond 2021. So it's really important that we put our best foot forward. So the debate around how to do this was really kind of reaching a kind of culmination around December, when the Department of International Trade civil servants we've been talking to encouraged us to think about going to NIPID, this international property conference. And in January, and we took a report to Cabinet to kickstart the work, and then in January, to answer Ian Lewis's question specifically, the creation of this post was the advice of the chief exec, the management team, the people who head our economic development department, that we needed these specific skills in order to put our best foot forward to get the maximum opportunity to promote Wirral at NIPID. And that was the reason why we waived calling, because we needed to have that short-term appointment to do the work that was needed so that we could promote Wirral to the best possible potential at the NIPID conference last week, which I did. So, you know, we talked to at least 40 separate investors. I presented the Wirral prospectus at the government stand on Wednesday. We met with ministers and civil servants and all of the key decision makers about that conference. So it was key that we did But, you know, there's a kind of tone that runs through these motions and these amendments of somehow this appointment was done in an underhand way. Absolutely outrageous allegation. And frankly, it's an insult to the integrity of the panel who conducted the interviews for this post, two of which were senior people from outside the council, chief exec of the chamber, the director of England Investment Liverpool Vision. And it's an insult to the integrity of a successful candidate and follows the kind of personal attacks that have been made, as I mentioned last time, against this one individual who can't answer back. So the appointment was made fully above board. There is no need for an independent investigation, and I believe it was needed as part of the really important work we need to make sure we bring this regeneration to the world. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And again, I wasn't intending to speak, but I think we should just be clear about this. And I think the issue for me is that this forms a part of the way the council is operating. So we've reached the stage now. I can remember in the improvement board where one of the key active actions that were impressed upon the council was not to cancel calling. So the council got into a habit, Phil was the deputy leader in fact, but the council got into a habit of waiving calling. And it was identified as a classic example of where the council was failing. Now what happened around this post? This post was established, but again, calling was withdrawn. They were told there could be no calling. Calling needs to take not a particular huge amount of time. The meeting can be called, we can have a discussion. And I do believe that discussion about why we needed this particular post, as opposed to using one of the 4,000 odd people that the council currently employs, or why we needed one on 404 as a total cost package, £440 a day, even though I understand the individual thinks of less than that. But why could we not? Why could we not have a sensible discussion about what it was that Liverpool Vision couldn't deliver? What it was about why the city region, the investment people, couldn't deliver? And for someone who spends all this time criticising the government, it becomes a bit rich from the leader of the council to say, well, it's all the government's idea because they said we needed to go. So we've had an example of this in terms of this particular post, and everyone was asking for was for it to be called in and scrutinised. We've got another example, same issue, I think, around the joint venture company, that again, at one time on the Friday it was fine, but over the weekend it suddenly became, calling was waived, and they were talking about apparently potentially, according to the leader's press release, up to £100 million worth of rural assets. And now we've been told we can't have any more than half an hour to discuss this particular issue and complain that the special councils get called. Mr. Mayor, the public have a right to have these issues aired out, discussed, and the administration held to account for the decisions they're taking. That's what being open and democratic is about. And I think my concern, and why I absolutely support this resolution and the amendment, is the administration need to remember that they're using the public's money for this activity, and therefore they should have a degree of humility and be open to the democratic process and accountability and scrutiny that comes with that. And I absolutely support this resolution.
Okay, Senators, Councillor
sure, I personally am unsure of the validity of this post, and I can put committee met on two occasions to appoint two senior officers, one in children's services and one to take forward our transformation agenda. Both appointments were made on a unanimous basis, and clearly they were both much needed by this council for the expertise and knowledge which they will bring to us. So hence that makes it even more disappointing, Mr. Mayor, to see that this Labour administration are now content to move away from that open and transparent process, which quite clearly has served us relatively in the mean very well for many years. I realise, Mr. Mayor, that a party executive made up of one political party has certain powers which of course they can exercise. However, I would have hoped that this power would still allow for full scrutiny on any decisions that are taken, but clearly that is not the case. So we have to ask ourselves, why has the Labour administration moved away from the employment and appointment committees? Who interviews and who appoints these people? Clearly not the committee. Mr. Mayor, I found out who actually sat on that committee to interview via Wirral leaks, and thank goodness for them in some ways. But Mr. Mayor, that's no way to run. That's no way to run an open and transparent council. And then, Mr. Mayor, we found out quite recently, mentioned in our budget amendment, that adding insult to injury, we find out that £1.3 million of council taxpayers' money has been spent on the appointment of consultants and temporary bosses. Who are these people who walk the shadowy corridors to the Leader's office? How were they interviewed, Mr. Mayor, and how were they appointed for those roles? If the Leader of the Council decides to play his card so close to his chest, how can the people of Wirral trust this administration with their hard-earned cash? Mr. Mayor, I doubt if we ask many members of this council who these appointed people were, again, who travel along the shadowy corridors to the Leader's office, who they were. So, Mr. Mayor, I'd say to the Leader, there's an idea, Phil. Why on earth don't you bring back the practice of senior officers taking their seats here in this council chamber at all council meetings? Because clearly, Mr. Mayor, they don't anymore, and sloppy practice has allowed this to happen. Laughably, Mr. Mayor, this chamber is supposed to be the centre of democracy for Wirral, and hence it should be treated that way. Mr. Mayor, I'll finish now. Our requisition of this extraordinary council meeting is more than just about the appointment of one person. It is certainly not intended as a personal onslaught on that individual. It highlights our concern and the concern, more importantly, the people who we represent, of the arrogance of this council.
Please,
I will, Mr. Mayor. Can I just say that secrecy and arrogance appears to be driving this council, Mr. Mayor. That's not a good way for this council. It's not a good way for personal reputations to be born on this council. Most importantly, it's not important. It's not good for the people that we all represent, Mr. Mayor.
Whatsoever. This on the back of a recommendation from the Chief Executive, so urgent that it didn't even appear in the operating model that was approved in December. Mr. Mayor, in comparison, it would take 8 months to recruit a Deputy Director of Children and Social Care following the Ofsted report. That speaks volumes about priorities. And to a practical point, Mr. Mayor, Cabinet needs to be consistent on the message it is sending. To the residents of Wirral, to the opposition councillors, almost every speech, comment and remark we've heard it tonight from the Cabinet tells us how bad things are and how there's no money left for basic services. Mr. Mayor, Cabinet, through his post, cannot then tell potential investors, developers and global capitalists how wonderful Wirral is and what a great place we are to invest. As any professional PR practitioner will tell you, mixed messages don't get results. We still don't know the details of all this disappointment. And it's a pity the Leader of the Council has not used the opportunity we've given him tonight in good faith to clear up some of the outstanding issues. We do not know whether the now vacant post of his personal policy advisor will be filled and whether at the same rate previously. We do not know whether the £350 a day quoted net